Father, we know as each day passes, that you give us a greater revelation of what that true godly love really is, Lord. Father, we ask right now that you just bless this food, that we're about to eat, that it might sanctify and nourish our body, Lord. Father, we ask that this night be a blessing to you. In the name of your precious Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Do.
yet speaking, I will hear. Louis A. Copeland Jr. was born in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And in his early life, he grew up around and in a faith farm and with his ministry. And he even lived for a short time the rescue mission on Southwest Avenue, and his phone number was 462-9312. That was his phone number. And he began his intake counseling there. Someone would call, maybe his dad is busy, and Louis would pick up the phone and say, oh, this is Louis, can I help you? And they say, can I have a bit of money, say no. The two words that Louis came into know first weren't like mommy and dad, and stuff like that, were no and basically. In his younger years, he was quiet, studious, disciplined, mature beyond his years. And he did not engage in a lot of the shenanigans of all those who were his peer group. He wasn't interested in things like that. And you could tell at an early age that he was, in fact, officer material. Now, some of his quirks came out just a little bit later in adolescence, in the wonder years. His first problems occurred when he tried to date, and he would always find his sister winding up in the back seat with him on these dates. Now, of course, that card's ruined everything. So he was hard pressed to find a date. And after a while, he got to know that Louis' sister was like in the back seat as a chaperone, and it was tough. So he threw himself into automobiles and cars, and what he liked to do was to drive fast. He would drive around Fort Lauderdale very fast. In fact, legend has it that his car did over 200 miles an hour one day on Sunrise Boulevard. Now, the fascination, the strange thing about Louis was that despite the fact that he speeded, he strongly resented the police department. The police department speeding. And if you can believe this, he was speed to follow them speed. So if you're writing to Ann Landers, it goes like this. It goes, Louis was chasing the cops, chase other people. Okay? I mean, how much did the Fort Lauderdale police appreciate that it was COVID? Not at all. And there was many a scene where it became clear to Louis that he was going to soon have to clear out of town. And he did this, eluding police. He finally sped off to Texas, in San Antonio, IBC. Eluding police, a girlfriend, a marriage proposal, and a weekly, expensive wedding ring engagement installment plans. That took that weekly paycheck and just went through. Anyway, Louis was to go to Texas, and he was a freshman. And, you know, being an intelligent boy, college life suited him well until they had the first freshman class meeting, and they wanted to know what's get a name for our freshman class. And Louis had been an achiever, an overachiever. And he'd been raised to think he was number one, and he was the smartest, and he was the best. And they asked him, well, what do you think the name should be, Louis? And he said, it should be the King's Men. He's like, we'll blow it up. But some humbler students, like maybe missionaries, kids, you know, they said, no, let's call ourselves the servants of all. That didn't cut. Louis did not see himself as a servant of all. In fact, it is rumored that he angrily stalked out of that meeting and threatened to pursue not only not in that class, but to lead school, and even school with majoring computers. Well, he did stay at IBC, and his dating life did pick up. In fact, he became quite the social individual about his sophomore year, and he, in fact, sponsored a trip down south of Texas, over the border, and into Mexico. And I hear him tell it like something with his family and everything, now, what they didn't like it. There were some guys, there were some girls, and that. side of the upstairs, to a secluded area of the dorm, all the way down to the end. And walk right into the room, and see what was going on. It was quiet, undercover, illegal poker game. Finally persuaded him to play in the game. He pulled out the chair, and they were playing for money. As the game went on, Louis started winning the whole pot. So all of a sudden, these guys were happy to see him at first, weren't so happy to see him. And as a matter of fact, and all of a sudden, Louis had had enough of this, and said, "Guys, I'm going back to the dorm with my money." They tried to persuade him to play, and even thought about turning him in now to the game. He turned around as he left. He says, "Louis, come back, play one more hand." And he says, "Don't worry, gentlemen, I'm going to tie the winning." He had a great time at IBC in a short time. He was married and he was living in Atlanta, Georgia. And it was, let me get it straight now, it was a big two-story house on the lake. He was making a lot of money. He was working for computers, one of the major companies. Computers had a lot of money. He drove a big car. He achieved at the Emmy Awards. And one day, as he was in the office, I think it was on Friday, he got a call from another famous Georgian. I think it was from Plains, Georgia. And I'm like, "Let me see." Louis? Hello, Louis? Yes, sir. This is your friend, Plains. And I'd like to congratulate you and your entire company on this tremendous job you've done at IBM. Beautiful. You're revolutionizing the world with computers. We are bringing it in. Jimmy, Plains. Louis didn't get shook up at all. He had bigger phone calls than that. And Jimmy had a question to ask Louis. He says, "Louis, I want to ask you a question. Did you vote for me?" There was a deathly moment inside of him. He says, "Basically." Thank you. come in and walked in and knocked on and just come in. And just have a seat. Said, how you doing? I said, okay. And he said, have you ever been in any other program before? And I said, this is my first one. He turned and he punched that computer up and he says, he looked at me, he says, Steve, he says, according to his readout, you've been in 57 different programs in 33 different states and you haven't completed any of them. And I said, well, yeah, I kind of maybe I'll exaggerate it just a little bit. And he says, here's a list of rules. He says, if I take you in, are you going to change? And I said, oh, yeah. I'm going to change. And so he handed me the rules. There's a wall of his rules. And he said, now you read those rules and get acquainted with them and then follow them. And I said, yes, sir. So as I was kind of reading through the rules, he had a phone call. He got a phone call. He says, well, this is Louis. And he came back to me. And I said, Louis, you know, my parents don't know where I am. My girlfriend, you know, can I make a phone call? And he says, no. I said, well, you know, why not? Why can't I make one? He says, well, it's in the rules. And so he says, you know, I've found in the short time that I've been here that the word that you drug addicts and alcoholics hate the most is the word no. And I said, yeah, you're right. Yeah. But Steve says there's exceptions to every rule. I said, he says, yeah. He says, why don't you ask me now real nice and polite? You can make a phone call. Well, I say I lit up like a Christmas tree and I turn to him and I says, Louis, Mr. Colbert, sir, may I please make a telephone call? He smiled and looked at me and says, no.
This was your idea.
Blow me again down the road. And it was It was wonderful. It really was. And we all really appreciated that. It was great. Okay, we have, where's Ricky?
He's having fun.
We lost him. Ricky Smith?
He'll be
here tomorrow. Okay. Well, Ricky Smith, he's going to come in and sing a song for you. And, well, I think, hey, Mary, why don't you go ahead and do your song right now, okay? Mary's going to sing a song.
You
can
You want us to help you, Mary?
Yeah.
I got some spoons back here.
Oh.
Out to us. The Lord told you to make an effort to, and He did. You were obedient. I never used to love anybody, much less be able to feel the love that I feel for y'all tonight. I know that I'll see you in the future, but I was very angry when I heard that y'all were leaving. Because we all do love you very much. Very special people. I came across something else. You know, the example of the life that you lead is more powerful than any words that can be spoken. The commitment and devotion that you have to God is never knew such a thing existed. I just thought it was something I was read about. I never knew the reality of anybody having so much faith, so much purpose. Maybe unforeseen purpose on the surface, but just an incredible underlying purpose. Just incredible. What an impact. I just can't tell you the impact that it had. Both of you, even Pam being silent, but we didn't see her that much, but Pam, even you had an incredible impact on all of our lives. I mean, a truly incredible impact. As to the way a Christian wife and a mother conducts herself and lives for God. We acknowledge your devotion and commitment to God too, Pam. We do. And we all truly love you too, very much. My heart is really touched. But because of the example that you have set for us all, the real example of being real people, not phony. Those are areas that surely we all still deal with. But it makes me look at the Lord. And I'd like to read you this. Lord, reality, make us real, not plastic, synthetic, pretend phony, an actor playing out his part, a hypocrite. We don't want to keep a prayer list, but to pray. Nor agonize to find your will, but to obey. To argue theories of inspiration, but to submit to your word. We don't want to explain the difference between eros and phatos and agape, but we want to love. We don't want to sing as if we mean it, but we want to mean it. We don't want it like it is, but to be it like you want it. We don't want to think another needs us, but we need him, else we're not complete. We don't want to tell others how to do it, but to do it. To have to be always right, but to admit it when we're wrong. We don't want to be a census taker, nor an involved person. A professional, but we want to be a friend. We don't want to be insensitive, but to hurt where other people hurt. Nor to say, I know how you feel, but to say, God knows, and I'll try. Oh Lord, if you'll be patient with us, and meanwhile we'll be quiet, we don't want to spoil the cliches of others, but to mean everything we say, including this. We love you, Louie, Pam, and Jonathan. Within the depths of each man and woman's heart in this room, that love that only comes from God, most of us never knew what it was before. I've run out of words, but that's okay too. I'd like Gary to come up right now, and he'd like to make a presentation, and then Joe after Gary.
Thank you.
come up. I got something that the alumni club would like to send to you. By the way, the alumni club of Okeechobee, the whole Okeechobee club, everybody in. Pam, I have something for you too. Would you come up? Speaking of your life after a while, but you know, maybe I'll you'll do your own. Says Lewis, Pam, and Jonathan, Okeechobee Faith Farm, Pioneers, 1988-89.
Realizing, man, he has been so strong. I realize I'm ready to go home. out of class. You have to take out time. And this is scary to know. And I really appreciate that. And they were saying that. So you want, you know, you want to follow them. But let me tell you something. We will be together in the next. Because I think the players. I know that. That's the fight.
You feel that it's hot serving around your neck. That fits on the side of you. I think a lot about that. And I want to say something about your parents that you were talking about. If you give everything to God, you know, something happened to it, you don't really give it to God. I love you. Both of you.
like, but we're too lazy to walk up to the microphone. So, you know, what can you do about it? When I first got here, we were in the first week of class. We had marriage counseling class, and Louis took Pam and said, I believe that my wife is just like the prodigal woman in Psalms, right? In Proverbs, right? And I thought, yes. And when I went back to Miami, I said, I have a lady taking care of my son, and her name is Perfect Pam. That's how Louis presents Pam as perfect. And I remember the day I realized Pam wasn't perfect was I walked in to pick up Matthew, and I believe Jonathan had been biting Matthew or something. She was frustrated with what was happening between Jonathan and Matthew, and she was crying. And I thought, oh, wow, she's human. And I also had a problem in the beginning thinking, this lady is no way she can teach me anything because she has no idea from whence I come. She doesn't know from where I come from. She doesn't know where our marriage has come from. And she's younger than me besides. So there's no way that she can teach me anything. And yet I have learned so many things from her. And when I was talking to somebody else, another wife, I told her, I said, you may walk into this and feel the same way, that the people who have not come from the backgrounds that you have come from can't teach you anything because they have not been through the hell that you have been through. But it becomes more a matter of teaching us of what should be and what can be. And Pam's wisdom and her quietness and her ability to listen. She listens so well. And then she did not pull punches. She'll listen, but she won't pull punches. And in our marriage counseling class, I think all of us have been on the punch end of it from her sometimes. She's kind about it, but she doesn't lie to us. And I'm really sorry to see you go. You know? I'm going to start crying again. Turn it off. Because I just, within the last four or five months, been able to receive from you. Because the first 2 months I couldn't receive from you. And it's just now that I'm getting to the point where I can receive from you, and you're leaving. And I really don't think it's fair, and I'm going to take it up with God tonight.
Now, in the last 2 months, it's some Matthew hasn't been receiving from John. Jonathan hasn't been bad in Matthew. Their relationship is still going to be breaking. And I kind of suffer for Matthew. I was telling Tyler, I'm sorry for Matthew, but I'm sorry for myself too because I get to love you two guys. And little Jonathan, he's like a family thing. And Lou is very special for me. And I told you a couple of times, and then I thought, I haven't been fair to Louis because I told you a couple of times, I watch you walk. Because I took you as a model, as someone that I would like to be like. And that's a lot of responsibility to put in you. But you did a very good job. And I really appreciate all the help that you can give me. And any time I went to your office, you always looked like you're so busy. And every time I said, do you have a minute? I usually took more than 1 minute. And you pay attention to me 100% all the time. I really appreciate that. I love you.
Yeah.
I would have waited. There's another reason why we didn't walk up to the mic. Neither Mary or I need a mic. I know you from a different end than some of the men. Everybody comes here to learn something. Not only the men, not only the wives. Children learn something here. You guys learn something here. I don't believe in goodbye. I've had a prayer going out for my family in Fort Lauderdale, who I love very much. And I have friends in Fort Lauderdale that realize that as much as a help that they've been, there's things that are missing. There's other things that can be done. And they have no idea what goes on up here. You guys know what goes on up here. My prayer was that they can be taught this way. That they can, it can filter down into Fort Lauderdale, and they can learn not only the business and the growth of healing people from drugs and alcohol, but of growing to God. And Fort Lauderdale is so big, the closest they get is to really healing people from drugs and alcohol. If there's too many people, but the more people from here, the more ministers from here that filter down to Fort Lauderdale, the men that succeed, you, the family, this can, it can really grow. In a monster city like Fort Lauderdale, the blessing can really grow. I don't agree with everybody by saying Pam's real quiet. I laugh with Pam, talk with Pam, joke with Pam, and sarcastic with Pam, and she is the same right back. I will miss that. I'll miss Louis's laugh and his sense of humor and his sarcastic little ha ha ha, I know. I will miss that, but I won't say goodbye. I love you guys.
Kids, you know, the teacher told me to get out of class.
have those qualities. You're a gentleman, and I respect you tremendously.
And we never one of us watched them. And so it was up to you and Louie every Wednesday night. And I know y'all were tired and we left and you washed our glasses. I appreciate that. And Louie, for you, I offer my sympathy because last week I gave Pam my recipe to Buffalo Chicken Wings.
Gave me strength and gave me that I can do it. And I Some people say that I'm hospitable, but I know that you guys have me. Your home is always welcome to anyone, whether you're welcome or not. And I'm really honored that ability to, your ability to do that. I've enjoyed your family videos of Jonathan and his grandparents. And we barged in on you a couple times. You didn't receive it as barging in. I appreciate it. Of the time to spend with you. I think all the things you're going to say and forget them, I knew that I would. But anyway, just that only a few words. So I suppose that's enough. I'm better at writing letters.
Kick my ground and tell you if it was him, but I know it isn't him over here, you know. I'd have kicked Pam too, probably, if not all his fault. But, I can receive it, you know why I can receive it, because I know what God's, what he's wanting to do. And I respect both of them very much, and he helped me. You know, he came here and helped balance me out. And you know, we're losing in their game. David's coming too, but the thing of it, your lives, since you've been here, you're part of our family. And I never did work for Billy, I'll tell you, I appreciate being part of your life. And Billy, you're dedicated. I'll tell you, I'm sure everybody, you're a dedicated man to whoever you're working with or anything. Your life is dedicated. And I think you are called. You need to know that you're called into this ministry. You love these men very much, and I know that. They know it. And, you know, I see a man that's working in his life. As long as you keep doing that, you know, God can use you where he is right now. And There's a lot of things I'd like to say, but I don't know how to say them. I don't know how to express myself or something like that. But I love you. I love you very much. Pam, I love you because you're faithful. You're a lady that cares about people. You care about that little boy, and both of you do, but you care about him. And you care about the ministry. You're not selfish. And I appreciate your ministry with these ladies. Because it's very, it's me. I don't know how to express, to tell you, I can't say it to you, but I love you too. I love John. And I think God's right. I don't want you to go. Mike had a better idea, but it wasn't God. They said maybe David, the way both can stay up there. See, God's got to work for you to live. You've got a whole lot of people for you to love. I'm going to ask you to do that. We have no brothers. I just ask you, I know what I want you to do. Two of them are in this room tonight. Now, many people ask me how I'm doing as it's a fine day type situation, but Louis is one of those. And further than that, he asked me, how's you and Teresa doing? And I really, really appreciate you two. The marriage classes that we've attended, also not as leaders but as participants. You've spoken into my life, Louis, and I receive that. You're my brother, just like my brother. I never used to cry very much either. I used to think it was supposed to be tough. I got brothers in this room tonight that are as close as my own family. And it is difficult. When I was in prayer and the Lord said,
swamp. And I know that was God, because usually I fight the flesh quite a bit when my flesh doesn't want to go along. Usually that's Him talking. And usually if I think it's a great idea, it's usually mine. I just know that He's going before you. I hear that in my spirit. And I don't even know what's going to happen. I don't know the future. I don't know. Nobody knows it, as we all know that. But I want to encourage you both in one area. We have both worked at that farm before. Both of us in a position that you have worked in before and what you're working on now. And I would exhort you and encourage you to not get sucked up in the fast lane down there. And don't get overwhelmed by all of the ministry that there is to do. But you keep your purpose and your goal, what God has put in your heart. And you're going to make your own job description down there. You know, there are certain things that you're going in over here to do, but there are more things that God wants you to do down there than what Brother McCormick or myself can design and put in the job description. He's sending you there for His purposes. Encourage you not to get so caught up in the overwhelming pain that is down there to forget what the main purpose is God has asked for you to do. We get so busy that we don't, you know, we go in 10 different directions and we don't remember what our purpose is. I exhort you in that. You want to say anything else? I've said enough, okay.
Yeah, I'd just like to say a lot of us come to the farm and
we get the opinion that we can't learn from a minister's son, that we have to learn from other addicts in recovered pain. And you really get that feeling. I just want to say, I started at the time when Mike and Tracy were in Boynton, and I figured because they were kind of like the presidents, that naturally you could learn something from them. But I figured that would be the only couple, probably, that, you know, would minister, and they
Christians, basically. You pointed a few things out to me, too.
Yeah.
If we're all Christians, we're gonna, even if we didn't see each other past this evening in our natural lives on earth, we're going to be able to spend eternity with each other. We're going to be able to worship and praise the Lord. And as I look at this time, first of all, I'm just going a few miles south, just a couple hours south, and there probably will be faces in this room after a month or so. People graduate, go their way, and I go my way. We probably will not see each other in this earth again. But I look at this as just another phase in my life, sort of like Bible school. And our Bible school is approximately 300 people. And many of my very close roommates, people that I had lived in the dormitory with and gone to college with for 3 years, I did not see them anymore. Every now and then I'll get a newsletter from, you know, one guy who was a very close friend of mine, a missionary in Mexico, and some other friends in Africa. But the majority of the people I don't hear from anymore, but I still feel close to them in my heart. And I think that we can carry that same love from this point on and love each other. But I think it all also really teaches a lesson on earth here as far as time. You know, I've had the privilege of working with you for a year, and each and every one of you in the student program, there's going to be a time for you to step out and to take another little part in your life. And so if I can say anything, it's just do not take your time now for granted. I really dig in. Get the strength that you need, that you can go out, and that you can be an example and walk it out as our paths depart, you know, so that we can be an example to others. And I just think it's been a great privilege to be able to work with each and every one of you. To me, it's more, you know, to me, it's a privilege to work with you. So I look at it, and just ask for your prayers. And you might say, well, you're happy or sad to leave. People ask all these different things. And, you know, emotionally, we can ask, you know, we can make one statement in our mind and maybe be very, you know, wanting to go, because I lived at Faith Farm, Fort Lauderdale for 10 years. I was born into the church, associated with the church 27 years. Next, lived on the property 10 years. So going back to Fort Lauderdale, to me, it's like going back home. But then again, I remember the concrete jungle of people climbing the fence and setting up. So emotionally you can question things and you say, do you want to go or do you not want to go? The bottom line is it doesn't matter. In my heart I feel a peace. This is when God sent us from Atlanta to here. I feel the same peace in this. It's not a matter of do you want to go or do you want not want to go. It's a matter of what does the Lord want? And I feel a peace in that. And there's not an excitement to say goodbye to you. But then again, I want to follow the Lord's will. And I think we all need to just take advantage of our time here and just see whatever God would have us. And I think that the farm is going to be